Ready.
All right, let's do it. Carissa, can we please have a one-word prompt based on the last dream that you remember?
Oh boy. Crying.
Oh man.
Oh
Okay, here we go. 3, 2, 1.
I will say, I think this movie did bring up some trauma for myself personally. I hate my dreams. I think if somebody was like, hey, would you want to never have any dreams for the rest of your life? I might take them up on that.
Oh, wow.
I think I'd rather just go to sleep and then wake up.
Okay. We have a lot to unpack here, folks, but hold on 1 second. Hey, welcome to the Overtalking Podcast with your host, Ken and CJ. Say hi, CJ.
Hi, CJ. I'm sick.
This is the show where we unpack trauma and dreams as chosen by our guests. And this week, we also watched a movie. And it was Dream Scenario, 2023's Dream Scenario with Nicolas Cage.
Movies are back, baby! Give this man the Oscar!
Okay, so before we get to Dream Scenario, let's maybe just straight up bring on our guest and let's unpack some dreams.
We're joined once again by fan favorite Karissa.
Hey, what's up, everybody?
What's
How's
up?
It going?
What's up? Welcome
what's
back.
What's up? Thank you. I'm so happy to be here. I honestly was going to invite myself back on if I didn't get an invitation from one of you soon. So I'm so happy to be back. I'm so happy I didn't have to strong arm my way in. I just got a real invitation. It was amazing.
There you go.
Of course.
We like to wait until it's just almost the point where people are questioning whether or not we still like
sure.
them. So it's,
yeah.
it's
sure.
good.
Yeah.
We stop responding to your texts, just kind of
yeah,
ignore you
exactly.
for a while. Really
yeah.
let
yeah,
that
I hadn't
resentment
seen any
build up.
Yeah, I hadn't seen or heard from either of you in so long. I honestly wasn't sure if Ken had even made it back from his honeymoon. I didn't know where
yeah.
CJ was. So happy to see both of you alive and well on camera. Well, not well. We heard from CJ that he is unfortunately sick.
I am sick. I'm hanging in there.
Yeah.
Thank you for being flexible and rescheduling.
Yeah. Okay, so CJ, you don't like your dreams? Why?
No, they suck. And it's not even that like... It's a lot of nightmares. I do have a smattering of those, but it's the feeling I get a lot of the times when I wake up and remember the dream is more just like, ugh, what was that? Like, just like this like
yeah.
weird, like, ugh, I don't like
oh,
that.
God.
Yeah. They're bad.
I didn't know that. I didn't know that you didn't like to dream.
Not a fan. I can't remember the last time I've woken up being like, that was fun or that was a cool dream. I like never.
Oh my gosh. Well, huh. That's really interesting to me. I'm sure I've talked about dreams on this podcast before because it's like one of the five topics that I rotate through. Because I have really intense dreams. I've always had really vivid dreams ever since I was a little kid to the point where as an adult, I think I might have like some sort of nightmare disorder because I have nightmares consistently, like every single night.
Oh no!
It's really intense. For a little while, it was so bad that it was like literally, I felt like I was like walking through the gates of hell when I fell asleep at night.
Jesus. And then, oh my God, I'm so sorry.
Like reemerging back into my life in the morning, like oh my God, how am I supposed to have a normal day now? But I'm also a lucid dreamer. Have either of you ever had a lucid dream?
I have.
Yeah.
I remember
I see you
that
nodding.
One.
Okay. Okay. Talk to me about it.
When I was younger, I would try techniques to specifically try to have lucid dreams when I would go to sleep.
Yes.
And succeeded
okay.
A couple
okay.
Of
what?
Times.
What types of techniques? What was successful for you?
I think it was. So I had a lucid dream, and then I was like, I want that to happen again. So I would try mm-hmm. to specifically remember that dream and try to enter back into that because I was at least self-aware enough in that to.
Interesting.
Fly. I just wanted to fly. That was
sure.
my main goal.
Of yeah. course. I mean, what else are you
yeah.
going to do?
Right.
My go-to was punch some people in the face. Like, oh, this is a dream. I'm going to throw
yeah.
some punches. And
nice.
I would punch a bunch of people in the face. CJ, you said you've also had a lucid dream?
Yeah, this was years and years and years ago. The part that I remember was we grew up next to a park. And I remember walking around the park. And then it dawned on me of like, oh, this is a dream. But then what I did was laid down on the sidewalk and then woke up. Like, I was like,
that's
oh, I know how
funny.
To, like, get out of this. Is like,
huh.
is like go
you
to sleep
wanna,
in the
like,
dream.
You didn't
and
take
then,
advantage?
Like,
yeah, you didn't
you
want to, like,
out?
To have fun?
No, because it was the first time that had ever happened. So I think I thought it was, like, weird and was like, wow, what?
Were you like, oh, this is a dream. I hate dreams. Get me out of here.
Probably. That was,
I just want to wake up.
One of the notes I wrote down from watching this movie is the teeth falling out dream. I have had like 50 times easy.
Me too. I have it all the time.
It sucks.
Yeah. Yeah.
And every single time I have the teeth falling out dream, in my dream, I think to myself, oh my God, I've had a dream about this, but this time it's real. Like every single time. Every single time. It's so silly. And then I wake up and I'm like, oh yeah.
I will say though, I never, like the person in this movie, I would never go in and actively pull them out of my mouth. I think that's an insane choice, even in a dream. What would happen for me is they would fall out in my mouth and I would be like spitting out teeth constantly. Yes. Be like, oh, what's in
that?
Yeah,
that's what happens to me.
Mine would go one step further. Mine would fall out of my mouth and I would choke on them.
Oh, God.
Yeah, I would feel it in my throat and I like can't breathe and I would choke on them.
Oh, oh my God, that's awful.
I think I did wake up and I was choking or like, I don't know. That's sleep apnea, right? That's like an actual thing.
Right.
I don't know.
Yeah, you might
need a
CPAP mask.
That's something you should talk to your doctor about.
Yeah, maybe. Ugh.
Have you guys also had I've definitely experienced in the dream you feel like you're falling and then have actually fallen out of my bed?
Yes. 100%. Yes.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yes. I sometimes though I'm just like still in bed, but in my dream I have fallen and I like startle myself awake as if I had fallen, but I'm just in my bed like normal.
Dang. This was,
I read that that's a common thing and it's your body's way, like you like jerk yourself awake, right? It's your body's way of saying you're falling asleep too quickly. And if you fall, you're not supposed to fall asleep that quickly. You're supposed to like ease into it. So it's like, hey,
that's
interesting. Too quick. Slow down.
Weird.
I don't know. I don't remember why.
That's funny.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've been having trouble where I wake up, where I think I've woken up, but I'm still dreaming, where it's like a dream within a dream.
Oh,
that's happened to me several times recently. And ever since I was a kid, I've used this technique to wake up. It's really not that interesting or exciting, but it's like you realize you're in a dream, you close your eyes really hard and you say, wake up, wake up, wake up. And then you open your eyes and I wake up. But recently, my brain is tricking me, and I do that, and I wake up, but then I wake up inside the dream. My brain's getting too smart for my technique. I have to figure out a new technique.
You're, like, outmaneuvering your own subconscious.
I am. It's weird, honestly, chess game. Yeah, I could talk about dreams all day. Like I said, this is, like, my whole personality. It's, like, one of the three things that make up Karissa.
Have any of you had sleep paralysis before and seen the shadow man at the end of your bed?
Only once, but yes. And it was so, so scary.
Yeah.
I have had the sleeper. You're half awake, half asleep, and you can't move.
And yeah, you wake up, can't move. And you know something's there, but I can't even like look at it. Oh, it's so it's the worst.
Yeah, yeah. That's really scary. That's only happened to me one time, but yeah, I don't want it to happen again.
No.
Do you guys, being two horror movie aficionados, does that ever like affect your dream? Do you guys have more frequent nightmares?
No, there's no way that my constant consumption of true crime and horror and thrillers, there's absolutely no way that that's creating these horrifying nightmares. There's just no way.
Are you sure? Because I kind of feel like it might.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like I'm a little desensitized, so I don't know if it...
Totally.
I don't remember a lot of my dreams anymore, so it's hard to say.
I wish.
I've been watching Band of Brothers again, and I remember having recent dreams where I'm like, oh, I'm in a war, and I'm probably going to die, and I just need to like come to terms with that, and it's awful. It's the worst.
That's really terrible.
Yeah.
Are you watching it because you're like, you know what? I could go for some young Vin Diesel. That's what he's so old in the Fast and Furious franchise. I got to go back to Band of Brothers.
Wait, Vin Diesel's in? I must have totally missed him.
I think a very small part, but I'm fairly certain that's correct.
Okay. Did he have hair in Band of Brothers? Is that why you didn't recognize him?
Maybe.
I don't know. I've never seen Band of Brothers.
Oh, maybe. Oh, is it Saving Private Ryan? Did I get that wrong? Yeah.
Yeah, it's Saving Private Ryan. Okay. I was like, I feel like I'm a huge fast head. Like, I would totally catch that.
I love how Fast and Furious comes up in every single episode. Like, somehow, we always come back to Fast and Furious.
We gotta keep Steve happy.
Look, we live in America. It's gonna happen. Yeah. Like, you can't have a conversation with someone without it coming up some in one way or another.
We should start playing, like, 6 degrees of Fast and Furious for every movie we watch and try to see if we can, like, tie it back to, like, well, this person was in a movie, this person was not in Fast and Furious.
I feel like you're already doing that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Gone in 60 Seconds is about a car movie that's starring Nic Cage. That movie has cars in it. Fast and Furious. There. Done.
Yep. That's all. That's all it takes.
That's it.
Easy as that.
Well, it's been a pleasure talking about our shared dream trauma, but we've got to talk about the movie. So we're going to talk about dream scenario and more coming up on the Overtalking Podcast.
Paul, you've been on my mind recently.
Yeah?
Because you keep popping up in my dreams. You don't do anything, you're just there.
Have you been dreaming about me?
Have I been dreaming about you?
Yeah.
There's like 100 messages. Somebody wants to interview me.
Well, this is strange. Maybe you should take a minute and think before you do anything drastic.
Why me? I don't know. I'm special, I guess.
And we're back on the Overtalking Podcast, joined by returning guest and longtime guest, Karissa. And we're talking about Dream Scenario starring Nicolas Cage. Karissa, we're going to put 30 seconds on the clock for you to describe for someone who's not yet seen Dream Scenario what it is all about.
Ready, go.
All right. We have college professor, kind of sad man. He is really sad because he isn't getting the recognition for his work that he feels he deserves. None of his students care about him until worldwide phenomenon begins to happen where people begin to see him in their dreams. And he goes viral, and he's finally getting the attention that he thought he always wanted.
But he
slowly begins to realize that he should be careful what he asks for.
Well said. Wow.
Yep.
Wow. I did think about it this time. Usually I totally forget that this is part of the podcast. But this time I remembered, and I did think about it briefly. I was trying to capture the essence without spoiling it.
Yeah, I think
because I really want people to see this movie.
Yeah. I feel like we gotta spoil parts
really
of it.
I really want to spoil it.
Oh, for sure. For sure. But not in the first 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not yet. I'll spoil it later.
Okay.
Really quick tangent, but before we spoil the movie, I forgot to talk about one more thing in my trip to Austin, if you'll indulge me.
Oh, sure.
Please, I want to hear about it.
But please tie it back to Nicolas Cage in some way. Okay.
Okay.
Or the Fast and Furious franchise, one or the other.
So it does involve cars. So there, done.
Great.
So
incredible.
While I was in Austin, Texas, I saw not one, but two Cybertrucks. And I know what you're thinking.
Oh my goodness.
They get ragged on all the time on the internet, but let me tell you.
I don't know what it is.
You don't know what the Cybertruck is? Elon Musk's?
Is it like a Decepticon?
The Tesla?
Like,
Ken, you got to Google it right now.
I want to see what I want to see your face drop when you see this.
Yeah, your live reaction.
Sick.
That was a reaction.
Dumb. Real dumb looking.
Truly very stupid. Yeah.
So
yes, very stupid looking.
Yeah. I know they get ragged on all the time on the internet. Everyone thinks they're dumb, but let me tell you, when you actually get to see them up close and personal, you realize they're really stupid.
Yeah, right.
Yep.
Yeah. They're so fucking dumb. Even dumber when you get to see all the actual proportions in person. They're so long. It's so stupid.
Yeah.
And everyone really who owns one should be ashamed.
It looks like the pretend cars that my sister and I would build out of cardboard boxes when we were children.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, a man child designed it. So yeah, that kind of fits.
Yeah. Yeah. I think you're actually spot on.
Yeah.
Didn't I see that one crashed into the Hollywood, some sort of hotel in Hollywood?
It
there was a Cybertruck that crashed into the front of the hotel and everyone was like, ah, sick. It's so stupid.
It was probably a marketing stunt.
Probably. Was the Cybertruck the one where Elon Musk had it on stage and was like, look how sturdy it is, and then shot at it or something, or punched it or something stupid?
No, one
of those two things.
What?
They threw this metal ball because he claimed that the windows couldn't be broken. And he brings some dude that worked on it that's not Elon. And even the guy holding this big metal ball turns to Elon and is like, are you sure? And he's like, yeah, go for it. And then whips it out the window and it immediately shatters.
It just shatters.
Like, there's a big hole. Of course, the ball goes through it. It's like, Jesus.
Oh my God.
God. And people think this guy's
truly
a genius.
So stupid.
He's so stupid. It made me so happy when I saw that.
That sounds like a weird dream almost, you know?
All right, there it is.
Yeah.
Segment.
There we go. So dream scenario. How do I talk about this without spoiling it? Because there's one part I really want to talk about.
I know. Well, I first want to just honestly speak to Nic Cage's performance in this. He is so good in this movie.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I think last time I was on or the time before that, we talked about Renfield.
Yeah.
And as listeners will recall,
we all loved it.
I used the word hate to describe how I felt about that movie. But what I will say is that even in Renfield, Nicolas Cage, his performance is incredible. He's right. So good. I love the new genre of Nicolas Cage. So he does not let us down in this movie. That's for sure.
That one of the things I wrote down was I was 10 minutes into the movie and I think this is my favorite Nic Cage character ever.
Yeah.
I think this is my favorite performance of his.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. He's really wonderful.
Yeah.
He's not really bald, is he? Or is that just
no,
makeup?
I don't think so.
It looked good. It looked
legit. Really good. Yeah. And he just plays a sad sack academic so well. I imagined that would be my future. And that I would be the one standing in front of a group of college age students who don't give a shit about me. But he really embodies that. I feel like I've felt what he has felt, and he really nailed that performance.
It's such as the movie goes on, you realize, usually the movie kind of focuses on a protagonist and we're rooting for him. But the more this movie goes on, you're like, no, this guy is a very unlikable person.
Yeah.
Oh, he is.
He's just kind of self-centered, selfish, has a big ego. And yeah, it gets kind of sadder and sadder. But at the same time, there was at least one or two times I was dying laughing. It's also very funny.
This movie has it all. It has scary moments. It has funny moments. It has touching moments. Yeah. I don't even know what genre to categorize this as. Would you call this horror? I don't think I would. But it has scary parts for sure. And it has some cringy parts. That's also for sure.
Yeah.
It's almost like sci-fi drama, maybe.
Yeah, totally. Totally. Yeah. Sci-fi is a good word for it. I hesitate to call it sci-fi because I don't want to scare people off, but that's what it is, essentially.
Right. No aliens or anything, but just the basic premise of the dream stuff that's going on.
Yeah.
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 It's funny you bring this up because IMDb does categorize this as comedy and horror.
That's so interesting.
IMDb doesn't know what they're talking about.
Yeah, true.
It's
genre, probably, which is like a catch-all for when it's multiple things, I guess. I don't know.
It's just a catch-all for Nicolas Cage movies.
Yes, for sure.
Yeah, I would say it's maybe a dark comedy, but not a horror.
Yeah.
Because it's not your typical kind of setup punchline, but it's that tension building and the release of the tension. And then you laugh really hard from that.
Yeah. CJ, I know you have notes. I want to hear what were some of your favorite or noteworthy parts of this movie before we start spoiling. Or we can now start spoiling. Warning.
Yeah, let's
spoilers
let's call
ahead.
It now. Yeah.
We're going into the spoiler country.
Yet, pause now. Go check it out.
Yeah. Please. This is a big recommend for me. Please go watch this.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, speaking of that, I do have an impression. However, it probably is going to only make sense to people who have seen the movie. Okay. Bear that in mind,
exactly
listener.
What you're about to do.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Ready? Let me get into character.
Yeah.
That was it.
That's good.
Yeah. That was
That's
it.
Good.
And scene.
That is the part that I also wanted to talk about.
So did you cue up? Did you cue up a fart sound? Did you use that? Did you make that sound with your mouth, or was that a fart? I need to know.
That's movie magic, baby. We'll never know.
Okay. Okay. So CJ farted live on air. That everyone needs to know
on demand.
Yeah.
On demand. Yeah.
Can you do
I
it again?
Honestly, until you.
Yeah.
Wow.
Oh, my God. The consistency. You really... Wow. And it sounded the exact same both times.
Yeah. I'm an artiste.
Wow.
Sure.
Well, we already knew that. I actually totally forgot about that scene. I think I blocked it out because it was so
that
cringe.
That was the highlight of the movie.
That was the hardest I laughed.
Yeah,
it's too. I mean, me too, for sure. I also think that's why I forgot about it, because it was so shocking.
Yeah. Very, very
would you like
cringy.
To give the listeners context?
Yeah, clue them in.
Oh God. How do I? Okay, so this
I'll let you describe this one.
Yeah. This will be such a treat for me. So more and more people are having dreams with Nic Cage in it, and this one woman ends up meeting him in person. And they go out for drinks and basically talks him into kind of recreating her dream, but in real life.
Because
she's like, this is so weird for me. We've never met before, but I've been having these dreams about you that are really intense. And they are sexual in nature.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what I was going to interrupt and say. To be clear, people aren't like all over the world. People aren't having sexual dreams about his character. But this one woman is like... I'm having the hottest dreams of my life, and you are the star.
Yeah.
And, okay, continue.
So, I should say, Nic Cage's character, Paul, is married. So, that's when, also while watching the scene, I'm like, no. They've had some drinks. They go back to the woman's apartment. She basically changes into pajamas to match her dream. She makes Paul go stand in the corner, which is how the dream starts. Paul, Nic Cage's character, does not say a single word in the entire dream. And she basically slowly creates it, and it gets to the point where they're on the couch, and then that's kind of where they start hooking up in the dream. And but Nic Cage in real life, his character reenacting this, gets kind of too excited and nervous and farts at one point. And then...
Not just one point.
Yeah.
Yeah, not... Nope.
Which is like... Man, the tension building of that is so good. Like, you're like, no, come on, you're married. Like, don't do this. Your wife hasn't done anything wrong. Like, you're such a piece of shit. And then they like, start to kiss, and then he lets one rip. And then I'll just say it ends abruptly from Paul's standpoint, and he quickly grabs his coat and leaves.
Yeah.
Well, but it ends while farting again, I believe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is the best.
Yeah.
God, it's so good. And it's so funny, too. I think, yeah, to set the scene, like, this character, he's not, like, a hottie.
No. He's
This character, I mean, Nic Cage, God bless him, he's not a hot oldie. There are some hot oldies out there, and he's not one of them.
Yeah.
And this character is not a hottie.
He's a schlep.
But, yeah, but even in the dream, it's not like he's being hot. He, like... creepily stands in the corner where you can like hardly see him. He's like in the shadows and he doesn't say anything, and then he just approaches. But hey, I'm not gonna yuck her yum. If that's what she likes, that's fine.
At one
but,
point
I don't think it
in real life, he in the dream, in the woman's dream, he doesn't say a single word the entire time. And in real life, he talks, and she has to say, no, can you, like, don't talk? Like, shut up.
Can you please shut up?
Yeah, like, this is ruining it.
Yeah, you're taking me out of it.
Yeah. As the movie goes on, though, the sort of, like, turn of it is, at first, people are like, whoa, this is weird. He's just in my dreams, whether or not you even have met him in real life. That's when people really get freaked out, is making the connection to, like, people that actually know that this man exists in real life. He's not just, like, a figment of their imagination. And it starts out with a lot of the dreams, people describe him as he's just kind of there. He, like, isn't doing anything. Yeah. He isn't helping certain, like, situations. But then as the movie progresses, that kind of turns. And now they're fully nightmares where Paul, Nic Cage, is, like, torturing them. And then that's the point where, like, now everybody hates him because they just associate trauma with this man that they've never even met a lot of the times.
Not even just hate him. They are truly horrified of him.
Yeah.
Cannot be in the same room with him, like fully traumatized by these dreams where he is murdering or scaring them in some way. There's one scene in this movie that is going to haunt me forever. It was so scary. The one where he like has the big smile on his face and he's marching into the room. Do you remember what
I'm
talking about?
That was his daughter's dream, I believe.
His daughter, yeah.
Yeah. truly the scariest thing I've ever seen. The best performance I've ever seen of Nicolas Cage. Horrifying. Truly so scary. I would also be afraid to be in the same room with him if I had had that dream.
It's again, that mix of like, that startled me for sure. And then a few minutes went by and I'm like, that's a very funny way to walk into a room and to kind of just swing all your limbs loose. Like, it's like if I saw a dude just like walking down the street like that, I would start laughing.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, but in the context of a dream, it's very scary.
No, because he just like runs into the room that way. And even running is a stretch. It's just kind of a weird swinging all of his limbs.
Yeah.
Yeah. But also scary.
Yeah, totally.
But then like it goes from there because he had already achieved kind of like worldwide notoriety from the initial part of him appearing in people's dreams. So he's basically a celebrity.
Yeah.
And now he's basically going through what happens when a celebrity gets canceled, even though he has no control over what's happening in these people's dreams.
Yeah.
And so he becomes very frustrated with his new found position because he really liked being very popular. But now everyone fucking hates him.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's so funny. Like, all he's ever wanted is like, maybe not fame in this way, but just like recognition. Mm-hmm. And he's finally getting the recognition and the attention that he wants. And at first it's exactly what he wants. And then it takes this turn where he's like, no, I want the attention, but not the bad parts.
Right.
And I want attention, but like for my work, not for the way that I'm showing up in people's dreams. But nobody cares about his work.
Yeah. He ends up getting hooked up with like sort of an ad agency or marketing agency kind of thing.
Oh my gosh, this scene.
Played by Michael Cera and Kate Berlant, which like that was another note I wrote down. I love me some Kate Berlant and anything she's in. I'm so excited when I get to see her.
Oh, she is a star. She's incredible and she's so good in this movie too.
Yeah. And they want to basically set him up with like, everyone knows who you are. You're like the most interesting person in the world. We could set you up with like any company and get paid a boatload of money to like endorse Sprite is the example they give. And he is being like, no, I'm an academic. Like, I just want a book deal. Set me up with like a publisher. Yeah. And they're like,
right.
But do you understand? Like, you're the most interesting. Like, no one's going to read your stupid book.
Yeah.
I also liked during that meeting, they like offhandedly mentioned like, oh, like maybe we could have some sort of deal with like Obama and like you meet him or something like that. And he latches onto that and brings it up like several times throughout the movie. And they're like, what? That's not really happening. Like,
yeah.
Doesn't he bring it up to his wife too? And he was like, they're going to set me up with Obama to like to impress her.
Yeah. Yeah. I love, man, I feel I really liked his wife in this movie. And also feels so bad for her that she's getting treated like shit.
She did not ask for this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, he's trying to like brag to her and she fully on the phone is like, you don't have to impress me. Like, where it's not like, I can see through what you're saying. Like, it's fine.
Right.
We're married.
Gosh. And he gets this book deal and he's so excited about finally getting to share his work with the world. And then they make him change the name. And I don't remember. Do you remember what they make him change the name of his book to? It's like, I Am Your Nightmare or something like that. And he's like, no. Like, and I love there's a line where he finally sees like the book and it's printed and it's bound and he sees a stack of them and he's like, oh, like that's it. It's kind of short.
It's very like thin.
It doesn't. Yeah. It's very thin.
It's maybe like 80 pages of a book.
Didn't he say like it was like a French translation, right? So didn't he say like, oh, maybe it's because it's translated to French or something?
Right. Yeah.
And they're along with the book, he ends up going to kind of a photo shoot for it. And they basically him like a Freddy Krueger claw.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Like, but you're like the nightmare guy. Like you're the dream person.
Yeah. And at first he resists, but then he like fully commits to the Freddy Krueger.
He's like, because as soon as he finds out that people will like him for that, he's like, all right, I'll do it.
Yeah.
Like, if it means people will like me, I'm all for it.
Yeah. Well, Ken, what was notable for you? I already asked CJ what was on his list of notes. What was notable for you?
We already talked about it. It's the cum farting scene. Like, I don't know
obviously,
what more to say about
obviously.
It.
Obviously.
God, so
I
funny.
Also liked at the very end, they had like set this up earlier in the movie, but he had asked his wife what if he could enter her dream, because by the way, he can't enter every single person's dream. It's like, I don't know what the percentage is, but it's like a select mm-hmm. portion of the population. And his wife is not included in that, but he said, if I could enter your dream, what would you want me to be doing? And mm-hmm. she wanted him to dress up as
David Byrne,
the reference
from Talking Heads. From
Talking Heads, in like a big boxy suit.
In the big suit, yeah.
And rescue her from an unknown issue. And at the very end of the movie, we get to actually see that.
It was very sweet.
Yeah.
Because by this point, their marriage has fallen apart. And he enters her dream, and he gets to rescue her wearing the suit. And what does he say at the end? He says something like, I wish this was real.
Yeah.
And then it just ends. It's like, oh, it's so devastating. Just like he finally gets to be the man that his wife wants him to be, but it's just in a dream because that's like as good as he can do. Oh, devastating.
Yeah.
I forgot the other part too that came before that, but it takes like a weird hard pivot towards the end of the movie, and someone cracked the code to entering other people's dreams, basically.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And like already mass marketed a bracelet that will let you, through concentration techniques, enter other people's dreams. And immediately there's influencers on what is essentially social network.
And
they're like, this is ripe for marketing. We have to get our billboards up in people's dreams.
That's right. That would happen. That's real.
It would. Immediately.
I firmly believe that's exactly what would happen.
Yes. I don't know anything about the metaverse, but can you market in the metaverse? Like, are there like billboards in the metaverse? Do you know what I'm talking about?
I'm sure.
Am I making any sense?
But if there isn't, there will be.
Yeah, I'm sure there
will be, right? Facebook
or Meta's model is advertising. Like, that's how they make money. Yeah. So I'm sure there is.
Yeah.
To set up the bracelet thing, like it's like a TV. It's basically like a news segment that is like catching us, the viewers of the movies, onto what has happened. And it's basically they're saying like, well, now it's proven that there actually is a shared subconscious with like every human on Earth. And because now that that has been proven, we can like, analyze it and manipulate it and stuff like that, which is like,
that's cool.
That is cool. But man, that would suck if true. I don't know.
Yeah.
That's really funny.
I don't think I want that to happen.
No. What if you could enter people's dreams with consent? Like, would you do that? Do you think you would use it?
So we're both aware of it. So we can hang out.
Yeah. Yeah. Everyone's consenting. Everyone's like, yeah, man, you can enter my dream. We'll hang out.
Then yes,
maybe.
Because that would probably mean I'm having better dreams than I am currently. And I will
try
anything
I can do to help improve that.
Some control over your dreams at that point too. So
yeah.
I can go flying now with my friends.
Yeah.
That's great.
With your friends and not just by yourself.
Right.
Yeah. Before we started recording, I was telling you guys that I have a pretty elaborate dream world that I can revisit time and time again. We don't have to get into it too much, but I have had a conversation with Eric where I was like, come visit me in my dreams and I'll meet you here. Cause there's a specific place. There's this, okay, I'm not going to get into it, but there's this treehouse. All right. In my dream world. And I told Eric, I was like, go to the treehouse. And what are you going to be doing when you're there? Like, how am I going to know that it's you and not just a projection of you? This is all hypothetical. And Eric's like, I'm going to be playing a drum set. So I go to several times I'm in my dream and I realize I'm dreaming and I go to the treehouse and no one's there. And I'm like, yo, you're not there. I don't know what's going on.
But Eric, guess what? Get your shit together.
Guess what? One time I went to the treehouse and guess who was playing a drum set?
Oh,
seriously?
It was Eric.
Wow.
Yeah, seriously. He was there. And so when I woke up in the morning, I was like, Eric,
you did it.
No. It's not like he's astral projecting every night and being like, please, please, please go to the treehouse. But he was there one time and I got to tell him the next day, like, hey, you were playing drums in the treehouse. And he was like, that's sick. Haven't seen him there since, though.
Dang.
Yeah.
That's very cool.
But
that's awesome.
All of that to say, yes, if I could enter people's dreams with their consent, I absolutely would.
That'd be great.
This is a fun new world to play in, honestly.
Yeah. If I could control it, too, like, okay, we're going to hang out together and we get to pick the activity and the setting and environment.
Right.
then yes, just, absolutely.
And it's not just the Shadow Man chasing us.
Right. Yeah. It's not like a nightmare. You're not like helping each other escape from some sort of attack. That's what's always happening in my nightmares. There's like an active shooter or something every night. Jeez, it's great.
Christ. I've had that dream where I've been shot and you like feel pain in the dream.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
God. Yeah. Or the one where you go to scream and no sound comes out. That's always a classic.
That's happened to me. I'm always running from something and then I can't because it's like mud, but
yeah, not really. I end up trying to like crawl fast because my body has forgotten how to run.
Exactly.
Fun stuff.
Wow. If only Nicolas Cage was there to save you in his big suit.
I would love that.
Well, I think it might be time to test your guys' knowledge on Nicolas Cage because it's time for...
Hey, did you know that?
That's right. For new listeners of the show, this is the trivia portion where we pit our guests and CJ head-to-head to see who knows the most about what we watched. Karissa, CJ, are you two ready?
Ready.
Ready.
All right. First question is true or false?
Perfect.
Nic Cage came up with his own hairdo for this movie. True or false?
True.
Yeah. Because you're asking, I'll say true.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, I always find these fun facts, and I don't know how to work them in other than just a true or false question, but yeah, it's true.
I love
Apparently, for most of his movies, he comes up with his own hairdo. That's like his thing,
that's
I guess.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Whoa. Interesting. Very interesting.
Yeah. All right. Next question, also very Nic Cage-centric. This is open-ended, though, so good luck. Nicolas Cage's own brother, Mark Coppola, appears in this movie in a very minor role. Did you spot him?
Is it the dude at the Halloween party dressed as a Nic Cage character?
No.
Is that Andy Samberg?
That would be funny.
It did look like Andy Samberg.
I Googled it after. I was like, is that it? Because Andy Samberg has done Nic Cage impressions when he was on SNL.
Right.
And he like shows up and looks like Nic Cage. Or is dressed as Paul. Sorry. He's dressed as Paul.
Oh, okay.
Because he's gone viral. And so people are starting to dress as him at a Halloween party. And you only see this man for like a split second, but it looks like Andy Samberg. And I thought that would be very funny.
Yeah.
No, I have no idea.
But no. All right.
I don't even know where to start.
So at Richard's dinner party, the first time we see this dinner party, there is a man at the table that they're like, oh, hey, he kind of looks like this guy. That's Nicolas Cage's brother, Mark Coppola, because he
oh my gosh,
kind of looks like him. He's bald and, Paul. Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
All right. Next question. This movie premiered at the Toronto International Film Festival, or TIFF for short. How many years in a row does this make for Nic Cage having a film at TIFF?
Oh, wow.
Ooh. What are the rules?
It's like more than
like
one.
Highest without going over,
closest,
or like
just closest, just
like closest. Closest without going. Okay, just closest, just closest. Closest. I'm gonna say 7-5.
Chris is closer. It's 10. This is his 10th year in a row he had a movie at TIFF. Yeah,
that's incredible. I didn't even know he'd released a movie every year for the last 10 years.
Yeah,
apparently. I don't have any of the movies in front of me, but it's true.
And I trust you.
We could dedicate a year of this show to just Nicolas Cage movies easily have truly material.
I think that the reason we get so many Nic Cage hits is because he says yes to everything.
Yeah.
So he'll just say yes, 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 churn out a bunch of stuff that's like mostly garbage, but when it hits, it hits. Yeah. And I just think like he must be saying yes to everything. I love that. I respect that.
Yeah. I know at one point that was to dig himself out of a tax hole, but
it was for money.
He's out of it by now, and he just likes making movies. Yeah,
right.
Well, yeah, so that kind of leads me to my next question. Including this film, how many movies has Nic Cage made, meaning appeared in total up to this point?
Closest. Okay. Okay, more than 10.
It's more than 10.
All right, smart.
Okay,
smart.
I'm going to say, thank you. I'm going to say 45.
I was gonna honestly, probably 100.
CJ is exactly correct. It is 100.
100?
This is his 100th movie. Yeah.
Oh
this
my was his god. 100th
movie? Yeah.
Wow.
That's incredible. Yeah. That's crazy.
Okay, there you go. 2 years of this show to just Nic Cage movies.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, Ken. Start from the top. Name them.
Face Off.
Yes. Classic.
That's it.
Wicker Man.
Pig.
Pig is so good.
Man, that's Mandy. Good. Ooh.
Oh, Mandy,
Color
also.
Color Out of Space.
Oh, yeah.
The Unbearable Weight of Massive Talent, where he plays himself.
I haven't seen that one. I haven't seen that one yet, but it's on my list.
Actually, I haven't seen Pig yet either, but I need to see that.
Oh, Ken.
Pig's so good.
I'm so disappointed in you. I'm not coming back on until you've watched Pig.
Hey, how about you pick it next time?
I haven't been allowed to pick the last few times. Oh, that's good. Okay.
Oh, did you not pick this movie?
I mean, I picked it.
That's right. She picked it.
This seems to be becoming a trending theme on this podcast.
I don't know what you're talking about.
I picked it.
She said she picked it.
I picked it.
We can move on.
Sure. Let's stay tuned for next week when I'm sure that person also picked that movie.
That's right. Everyone has free will here.
Great.
Anyway, so the score's tied up, and next question. We're moving.
Great. Next question. How many A24 films does this make for having Nic Cage in it?
Ooh.
Ooh. I don't know.
Seven?
No, I'm gonna say four. Four.
Chris is closest, but only because this is the only one.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I did not realize that. I guess I thought some of those others that we just named off, like some of the newer kind of weird
like
ones.
Mandy or Color Out of Space.
Is Pig and Mandy aren't A24?
No.
Oh, that's Neon, right? Mandy's Neon
exactly.
Or something. Yeah. Disappointing in myself.
It's okay. Yeah. I mean, you got the point, so you were closer.
That's true. I mean, right. I'm so proud of myself.
Maybe final question. What is the Rotten Tomatoes tomato meter score in percentage closest without going over for Dream Scenario? Chris, since you're in the lead, you go first. For those who don't know, this is the critic score on Rotten Tomatoes.
All right. I'm going to say 93%.
Okay.
Oh, that's a great guess. I'm going to go a dollar just in case it's not that high.
Yeah, man, that's a real shame. Karissa, it was closest without going over, and you were one over.
Mm-hmm. No, I should have gone.
Dang.
CJ gets the point, which leads us to our actual tiebreaker, where, on the count of three, you will both say out loud what you think the letterbox average rating is out of five. It goes to one decimal point.
Yeah.
Highest without going over again?
Just closest.
Just closest. Okay. You probably already said that, but I was panicking and I wasn't listening.
It's okay.
I'm ready.
Okay.
Okay. Here we go. On three, you say it out loud.
On three. Okay.
Yes. One, two, three.
4.1.
4.1. Go!
It's very delayed on my end, but...
I'll edit it so we say it at the same time.
Great. Okay, that's unfortunate. As a tiebreaker, that's really tough. All right. It is not 4.1.
You didn't say we had to say it fastest.
I didn't. I said on three. I'm sure it was a delay on Zoom, so it...
Yeah. So I said it first, right?
No.
I mean, ideally, you both should have said it at the same time, but it was 3.5. Is the correct one.
Oh wow.
Okay.
Wow.
Yeah. It really
disappointed in viewers.
Letterbox scores really average out to pretty
like
middle.
Like three something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So here's what we're doing.
What about audience score or IMDb?
Yeah. We're going IMDb. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Those snobs at IMDb.
Same rules again. Out of 10, what is the IMDb rating for Dream Scenario?
Okay. Say
I'm not
it
even
on
gonna
three.
Give you time to think about it. Yeah. Three.
Okay, I'm ready.
One, two, three.
7.5.
Seven. I thought that was a practice run.
No.
I didn't have time to think.
That's okay. But you know what? CJ, you get the point because it is seven exactly.
Oh, dang.
Wow. Yeah.
Congratulations.
I'm the winner.
You're the winner, yes.
Wow. That was close, though. I'm proud of both of us.
Yeah. I'm proud of the users of IMDb for giving it at least a 7.
Yep.
Yeah. IMDb is usually kind of all over the place. All right. Well, I think that leads us to our ratings.
You've heard us debating. We know you've been waiting. So now it's time to hear our ratings.
Chris, on a scale of 1 to 10, what would you rate Dream Scenario for you?
For me, Dream Scenario is a solid 8.5 out of 10.
Okay.
This is an exceptional movie. I love it. It's not perfect, but man, it's just a good time all the way around. I want to give it a 9. Oh, maybe I'll give it a 9.
Ooh.
I changed my mind. It's a 9. 9 yeah. out of 10.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. 9 out of 10. It's exceptional. You know what? The more Why I think I about it, and I was reminded, like, you know, I reserve a 10 out of 10 for my very favorite
do
movie.
Do it.
No. That rating belongs to Mithrigan and Mithrigan alone.
But I don't even know if we're going to have you back on for good at this point. Like, dear God.
I'll never hear from you ever again. But no, this is a 9 out of 10 for me. It's excellent. It's so, so good. Highly recommend. Everyone should go see it.
Nice.
Ken, you go next.
Yeah, I'll go next. For me, I'm going to give it a solid 7, I think.
What?
Okay.
No, it's 7's good for me.
Yeah, 7's very good for
Ken. You know how
Ken.
Critical I am.
Yeah, like, speaking of snobs. Pretty good.
Especially with anything that has any... like glimmer of comedy in it, Ken's already knocking it down a peg. So
yeah,
don't make me laugh. Come on.
And remain dead inside.
That's right. Yeah. How am I supposed to keep having these horrific nightmares if there's like comedy in there? God. Also, total segue, but the worst sleep I get is when I have funny dreams, because I will like laugh out loud when I'm and like kind of wake myself up. It's really weird.
You have funny dreams.
I want those.
Yeah.
Give me some of those.
Wait. What happens in funny dreams? I truly just a foreign concept to me. But when you wake up, do you reflect on it and think like, oh, that wasn't actually funny? Or are you like, man,
no,
my brain is so,
I'm thinking
so,
like, damn,
so
I'm pretty fucking clever. But then I forget it immediately.
Of course. Of course.
Just take my word for it. Anyway. 7 for me. I think it's a really good movie. Obviously, Nicolas Cage is amazing in it. Really interesting ideas. I think it's kind of towards the end where it falls apart for me a little bit. I think it really takes a hard turn once he like goes away and then they crack the code on collective unconscious. So yeah, I don't know. Anyway, that's where it fell apart a little bit for me. But still a good movie. Highly recommend it.
I highly recommend a seven out of ten.
It's good. That is good. That's solid.
Yeah,
man.
You put an asterisk next to it, and it's like, oh, it's a Ken 7. Like, yeah, okay. Oh that's like a
Come
CJ 11.
On. It's for yeah. me. It's not like a... It's not like... If I was rating this critically, for like as a critic, it would still be a 7. Okay, CJ, go ahead.
Snob. For me, this is also getting a 9. This is so wow. good. Woo! I had such a good time.
Yep.
This man, I was laughing so hard at that scene and at other parts. Like, it is so, it's cringy, but like the way they cut the tension is so good.
Mm-hmm.
I loved the turn it's where so all good. Of a sudden we're watching like a commercial of Dream Influencers. I really like that. I thought that was funny.
Yep.
Okay. The other note I had down, there's a scene where Nic Cage is at dinner with his family at home. And he sort of says no phones at the table because both his daughters are like scrolling on their phone. And then his phone elsewhere in the room starts going off and they're like, aren't you going to get that? And he tries to just like ignore it and be like, no, I'm talking, like, just forget about that. But it goes on for so long. And it's so loud. Yep. It's like, I love this. This is funny. It's really good. Highly, highly recommend. And that is a 9. Highly recommend. Ken shrugs.
Yeah. Whatever. All right. Well, with that, Karissa, thank you. For joining
Thank
us, lovely as always. Do you have anything you want to plug or any words of wisdom at the end here?
Words of wisdom. See this movie.
That's right.
It's excellent. Don't listen to Ken. It's not a 7 out of 10. It's a 9 out of 10 at least. So those are my words of wisdom. I have a plug that I'd like to do.
Please.
If that's okay. Cool. I listen to this really, really great podcast hosted by two of my lovely friends whose names are Ken and CJ. And the podcast is called Overtalking Pod, and I really think you should give it a listen and make sure that you rate it 5 stars everywhere that you're able to do that. And also, they spend no money on advertising, so that if you could share with a friend, that would be really, really lovely.
That would.
Thank you from me specifically.
Wow,
that would be so lovely.
Yes, absolutely. And thank you for saving me from the Overtalking overlords this week, because they're not even here. They were just already appeased. That's great.
Wow. I was really going to try to do the whole monologue, and I was practicing earlier, and I just couldn't do it. I was like, I was getting tripped up on the...
Yeah.
I was getting tripped up on the website that doesn't sound real, so I just... I figured I'd hit the highlights.
But it is a very real website at overtalkingpod.party. It's a real domain that people could have. And you forgot the part. So when Ken does it for the listeners, his eyes roll in the back of his head. So he couldn't do that part. So
That's right.
Yeah,
and his back bends at like an unnatural angle. But yeah, they didn't come. I don't know. I didn't look around, but I don't see them here. So
that's good.
That must just be a Ken thing.
It is.
Yeah. It sucks. Something I wanted to start asking our guests at the very end is, aside from this movie, have you seen any other movies that you just really quickly want to recommend to people?
Ooh.
Okay. Yes. This is a really great question. And I'm going to give you a surprising answer. Every year, well, not every year, for the past 5 years or so, Brother Eric and I have been trying to watch all of the horror franchises. And so we've watched all the good ones at this point. But we recently just finished the Paranormal Activity franchise. Mm. And nice. What I will say is that the first few movies, okay, first one, it's a hit. I love that movie. I understand other people don't, but it's fine. If you weren't in the theater at, 15 years old or whatever, seeing it for the first time, I understand. But sleeper hit is Paranormal Activity, The Ghost Dimension. We watched it last week. It's truly so scary. It's okay, now I'm overhyping it. It's so good. Highly recommend. And it was one of those where I laid down in my bed and couldn't fall asleep because I was too scared, which never happens to me. So if you've given up on Paranormal Activity after the second or third one, I understand because they're starting to get boring. But watch The Ghost Dimension. It was very good.
Wow. Is that the one that was released in 3D?
I don't know.
I do not know. Pictures like Mario?
I have no memory of that. And I've seen the whole franchise. So
I'm pretty sure that's the one. Anyway, that was really cool. Okay. I like that one. I also liked the Marked ones.
We also watched the Marked ones. Yes, that one we watched recently, and it was also very, very good. So and then while we're at it, you gotta watch the newest one with Dan Lippert, because he's in it, and we like him, and we want to support our buddies who aren't really our buddies.
I like that guy.
But I wish we were. Yeah, he's a good guy. Seems like it.
Kenneth is the one in 3D.
Those are my recs.
Okay, cool. I thought so.
The Ghost Dimension.
So, yeah. So if anyone has any recommendations of the next franchise we should start, I will not run through all of the ones that we have already seen. I truly can't think of a single other franchise right now. So if anyone has any recs, I'm open.
I do. So there are these guys who have to steal a bunch of DVD players, and they drive these fast cars. It's
it's not a horror franchise, I don't think, but it's
horrific
good.
How fast they go.
That's right.
You know what? You've sold me. I'm starting from the top.
I can't think of it off the top of my head. I'll text you afterwards. It's blem.
Okay. Cool.
I have one too, and we're going way hot on time, but. Meg and I just finished the Twilight franchise last night, and boy, let me tell you,
Karissa did that. My
it's really good.
God. Wait a minute. You didn't? This is the first I'm hearing about this?
Yeah. Well, I just finished it last night.
We'll save this conversation for next time. I have so many questions, but we'll save it. So now you have to have me back.
Okay. Great. But we can't, it can't be on Twilight because I am never watching them again. It'll be a tangent.
Okay, right. I'll spare you.
Thank you. All right. Where can people find us, Siege?
Follow us on all the things at Overtalking Pod. You can go to our very real website, overtalkingpod.party, type in the word Karissa, find all of her previous episodes, email us like actor Wayne Knight did at overtalkingpod@gmail.com or call or text us at USACAT1591.
That's it. As we always say at the end of every single episode.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
This episode of the Overtalking Podcast was produced by Ken and CJ, edited by CJ. This week's special guest was Karissa. Music by Justin Peters. Logo by Nate Richards. Check out Nate's work on Instagram at Nate Richards Designs.